How are we doing? Thanks for tuning in once again. If you've not already hit that like button and the subscribe button, that'd be nice, wouldn't it?
It'd be splendid, Chris.
Very much appreciated if you could. Thank you very much.
And a big thanks to One Football for sponsoring this week's episode. If you don't know what One Football is, it's a completely free app.
Well, I'm downloading, because if it's free, I'm downloading it.
Nothing.
Instant goal notifications, instant team news, transfer rumours.
What more can you want from a football app?
No, well, like a bit of transfer gossip, don't we?
Under one roof.
Oh, like we've done there.
All on one app. The link's in the description for the Android and iOS store, so you can just click on it. Click on that link, it'll take you straight through. You can download it for absolutely
nothing. We've missed one out, actually, that you should probably have got. Injury news.
Injury news, yeah.
Injury news, because if you are putting a coupon on, you like to know if the top scorer is playing or not, don't you?
Instant.
You would have been getting the headlines. So yeah, the link's in the description, just click on it, and you're straight on through to the iOS.
Brown starting for Blackburn. Well, we'll obviously go under 1.5 goals.
We didn't say it was reliable news.
And hit that like or subscribe button.
Thank you very much.
Is that right? You didn't get on with Van Nistelrooy?
That I didn't.
Ronaldo didn't.
I don't know if they really hated each other, but they had bust ups, you know. Like they were quite intense characters. Ruud Van Nistelrooy was intense, like especially when training. But I think he was the main man, and Ronaldo came in and kind of
took some of the limelight.
Yeah, exactly. So it was competition.
He used to shoot a lot though, didn't he, Ronaldo, as well, when he first came from obscure angles.
Yeah.
So Ruud must have been like, any fucking chance?
Exactly. And it went off. I can't remember where we won. We lost to Lille in the French Olympic Stadium. Again, I think I was third choice and it went off there between them two because of that, because he's not passing or whatever.
Just arguing or?
Yeah, just arguing, never physical, whatever. Never physical, but you got top athletes wanting to go at it. And I think if you get similar characters, I always find they clash, especially like, but you know, it was nothing crazy, but it was definitely true. They definitely didn't get on like a lot of players, but.
I wonder if he nicked a bird off him as well.
Yeah.
Might have stemmed from that.
Yeah, no, I don't know how much Ruud really had though with all that, his dress sense. And
on that, did you use to be. Not big time, but you must have made the most of being a Man United player in Manchester on the scene back then.
Who, me?
Yeah, all of you.
No, it wasn't like that, John.
No?
It wasn't, mate. I wish I could say it was. People say, even my missus now says about Manchester, and it was my quietest time because I went there thinking it would be so like professional and intense throughout the academy, and I was scared to like mess that up, that opportunity.
Yeah.
So even when we're on the Christmas doing stuff, or a night out in South Africa, I'd probably like be a bit more reserved, wouldn't drink, but you wouldn't really go out. The first team players would hardly go out. You'd never see them. Ever. Rio would go out, people like that. But, you know, you wouldn't see. And if they did go out, they went to their normal pubs and their places where they were safe. They never went to the so-called top places. It wasn't like that. And some of the young players did, went to like Wednesday nights out, but I didn't really get involved that much. I didn't find drink until I was about 21, 22.
And then loved it ever since.
It just took the edge off it all. I was so much better. I wish I had been a bit more Jack the Lad. I wish I'd gone out and kind of made little mistakes, because I think they liked that. But I was just trying to be this perfect, like, young pro.
Yeah.
But I wish I'd kind of, like, I wish, obviously, the old saying, I wish I knew what I know now.
Yeah.
Mm. Going back to Ruud, you weren't there during the Christmas. We speak about it when Chaddy was on you, when the
pantomime. Team,
yeah, the pantomime type thing, when somebody came dressed as Van Nistelrooy, as a horse.
Yes. I was in that.
What, in the horse?
Back end. That's definitely Steele. Look at the legs at that.
Yeah, I got involved in that. I think I was director. But no, I was dressed full as a woman, actually. I was taking the mick out of one of the staff members. But yeah, that was class. Ruud didn't react well at all to that. Didn't like that. Which basically every year, the younger players, the kind of initiation, they do a Christmas pantomime, and mostly it's mocking the first team players. So someone would take the mick out of Bex for being like prima donna, all the normal ones. And, you know, Van Nistelrooy, someone literally in the middle of this, like, Mary and Joseph giving birth to Jesus story, which was obviously with all the characters in it, it was this idea that one of the lads who just have Van Nistelrooy's kit on and a proper horse's head would just like run across the back, and it was like the best bit of the whole pantomime. Everyone was in bits, like it was so funny because he was just like moving and dancing around. And then, but yeah, Ruud didn't really take well to that. But you know, who likes being called a horse? I don't know many.
Not unless you
depends on which department.
Yeah. I don't know many people do, but that was brilliant. Yeah, all that sort of stuff. There was this, another thing called Fun and Games, which has been totally abolished now, but that was where you went into the first team dressing room as a first year, because it was like first team reserves and 19s, and you go into the first team dressing room and then there'd be like David May, Nicky Butt, Giggs, Gary Neville, and they'd make you do stuff. So it might be you had to make love to the physio bed. You had to do a rap or something, like Kieran Richardson had to do a song, and things like all those stupid like games and things. And there was people that petrified that they'd be hiding in the bushes in Carrington. They wouldn't come out. I know players who didn't even do it because they're that petrified. But it's one of them good, like it's one of them things that you do and you make a fool of yourself, and then like you're like, ah, oh, yeah, it's brilliant. Do you know what I mean? The old spoon one on the head and things like that. But it was good.
What was your one?
My one, I had to chat somebody up, so I had to basically pretend that Nicky Butt was this beautiful girl.
Ooh, and I had to chat. It's hard to get into that character, I'm sure.
So obviously I just used the same chat as I did with Ronaldo's bird, but like, and that's stuck with me ever since. But yeah, I didn't mind all that. Even now, I don't really enjoy initiations, but they're good. They're good to get things going. I think the whole football world, if anyone's listening, let's change it from doing a song, because it's getting a bit boring now. People need to come up with something different and something new, because everyone's a bit awkward when someone has to sing.
Mix it up a bit.
Mix it up a bit, yeah.
You need to be one for your Sunday league team, did you?
Not yet, no. Not yet.
So you're disappointed then when it was looking like you were going to have to move on?
Not really, no. Because the money was great at West Brom.
Yes! We finally had somebody honest on.
Yeah.
Finally got somebody who's...
John and I have spoke about this money issue and the honesty and stuff like that, but it took the edge off. It sounds madness and you laugh, but... I remember, I think it was on a pre-season tour in Asia or somewhere, and the gaffer spoke to me and said, look, Brian Robson's seen you at Coventry and, you know, thinks, you know, it'd be great if you could come to West Brom, and we're on about getting Ben Foster. So as soon as he said the Ben Foster thing, obviously Ben's, I think, a year or 2 years older than me, and that didn't obviously add up, you know. When if it was somebody like a lot more experienced or a lot younger, it's different. But when it's someone just ahead of you, yeah, it didn't add up. But Ben came in, I saw Ben and I thought, he's decent. And I remember thinking, it isn't anything else, but I think Ben's got a chance of playing in the first team. I think he's better than me. I think he's going to be better than me. It's probably a negative attitude, but...
Who was the keeper in at minute?
Van der Star was still number one.
Oh, sorry, I thought you meant this was at West Brom, because didn't Ben Foster go to West Brom?
Years later, yeah.
All right.
Yeah. But then I could see that Van der Sar wouldn't last much longer. They needed somebody to replace him. Tim was leaving and all the rest of it. But then, Brian Robson called me himself, which is another thing. Like, even this summer, I've had four offers, right, from clubs, totally off subject, but not one manager has made the call. And it's been happening over the years. And I've noticed it. I've told my friends that, like, you know, what's this, sporting directors ring you and scouts and people like that ring you? And what's wrong with the manager ringing you? You know when you get a call from the manager,
you know,
the top guy, it's great, and they talk and they build you up, and you think, you know what, I will, and that money that I thought I'd get, it doesn't matter, because it gives you that closeness and that straight away you've got that contact with the first team manager. Well, now it's all sporting directors, and they're missing out on players, because I know this isn't the reason I haven't signed for those teams, by the way, but I know players who have retired. One to say is James Morrison. I mean, I told you a story. He was going to go somewhere, and he said, you know what? I was going to go. I didn't care what money, but they kept sporting directors keep ringing me and not the manager. And I thought, you know what? I'm going to just retire, pack it in. And that's happening more and more. So that needs to be reversed, because I don't mind them sorting out the money and doing the deals, but it's crap. It's shit. Mm. It's got to be the gaffer. The top man's got to make the phone calls.
And like, you feel wanted then.
Yeah, that reminds me. Talking about ringing the top man and like making the phone calls yourself. We got banned from going to JJB Sports when I was at Barnsley. And this is the best thing the agent's done, actually. I found out that JJB was owned by Dave Whelan. And I just watched American Gangster, and I remember him going straight to the jungle to get the drugs. And I remember thinking, that's what I've got to be more like. And I remember saying to my agent, have you got Dave Whelan's number? He was like, well, we didn't really deal with... And I said, look, somehow, and he got me it. So I picked up the phone, I kid you not, because we'd been banned for like bad behaviour or something like that. They said that we've got to pay, and I was like thinking, we need the gym and all the rest of it. And I rang the number, Dave Whelan answered. This old guy who obviously multi-millionaire, I said, hi, I'm Luke Steele. I'm at Barnsley. I'm the captain and we've been banned from going to your gym. Blah, blah, blah. He was like, right, I don't really deal with this sort of stuff. And I was like, yeah, I know. And it was his personal number. And I was sworn never to tell like who gave me the number. And he said, look, son. And he sorted it. He said, look, I'm going to sort this. It's not something that should be, you know, you guys are the local football team. You're doing great.
Keep
it up. And within a week or two, we'd got full memberships back. And I don't know if they're still in there now, but I did that phone call. And since then, I always try and ring the top guy, not the guy who works the top guy, not the agent or the flipping sporting directors, the top guy. And I did that in Greece. This guy, I rang the president of
Greece. I'm going to park and ticket, mate. Can you sort this out?
Can you get that dickhead at fucking Olympiacos to sign me or what?
I'll tell you that another time.
Have you rang him since? Like
who?
Dave Whelan. Just like, hey Dave, I'm in the Peterborough branch. I'm looking at some Air Max. You know, you couldn't knock us 10% off, could you, lad?
I've been banned from the Peterborough branch. And the wife and kids as well will be happy. They've been banned as well.
Yeah. Some numbers you can't get hold of. But
straight for the top.
I've been trying to ring Boris for about 6 months.
What was the film you watched? American Gangster,
yeah. 2007, yeah.
Just to congratulate you on your new role, Mr. Biden.
Any chance you could just wing us on this travel ban?
You were a wanker that last
Fancy
one,
a week
Mr. Biden,
in Miami.
Weren't it?
Yeah. I've done some, yeah.
But it just, even that little thing like that just makes a lot of difference to players.
Yeah. They're humans. But going back to it, I just wanted to be serious for a sec. The managers have got to start making the calls again. Otherwise, you're going to miss out on a lot and you're going to have to overpay on whatever alternative you end up getting. But I don't even know what we were talking about before that. But
I did it, to be fair, at Fleetwood. When I was struggling with contract at Fleetwood, I ended up just phoning the chairman.
Yeah.
I said, look, can we X, Y, Z? Yeah, no bother. And I think Alexander hated the fact that I'd done that.
You'd gone over his head.
Cut him out.
Yeah.
He hated it, but he were a dick. Yeah. So you come into the time West Brom want to sign you.
Yep.
Did you get a golden hand check from Manu or?
No, not at all. I like I said, Brian Robson rang me, said that he wanted to sign me. I think I signed a 3-year deal. I knew, although I didn't go into this, but like the reserve football wasn't suiting me at all. Number three is a very hard position, especially when you've been out on loan. I didn't play well in the reserves at Manu. That was probably my weakest thing, getting my head around like the fact that I'm playing resis. I weren't big time, but I was like, I had no motivation. All I wanted to do was play first team football at that point.
How old were you?
I was 21. But the bottom line is, I wasn't good enough to play for Man United. That is the bottom line. There's not all this other stuff, money, blah, blah, blah. I wasn't good enough to play for Man United. That was the thing. Van der Sar was world class. You know, Tim Howard is better than me. I thought Foster was better than me. He's obviously proven it. And you know, and all this bollocks about, oh, you've got to give in, you've got to dig in. I dug in for 3-4 years, but I knew it wasn't going to happen for me. Didn't want to just sit on the bench for years. But so I left. I went to West Brom, which didn't really work out. It, you know, Brian Robson got the sack after a few weeks. Yeah.
Is this the season after the Great Escape then?
We're in the Championship now.
All right.
So this is the one where they went down and they were supposed to go straight up because they had a great team. But yeah, Brian Robson, another really good manager. He got the sack. Mowbray came in. Didn't really like Mowbray. I didn't really like him. And I won't say that about many of the managers I've had, but I didn't really like him. I thought he was quite dour. And he didn't, you know, take to me very well, which is probably the main reason. So just cut me off if I lie or whatever. But Dean Kiley got injured. I was number two. So played me. We won at Leicester. Then we won against Charlton. I made one mistake. Went top of the league and then he dropped me. and put Dean back in because Dean was back from his injury. But it was my little chance and I was in there, but it just didn't work out. And then they offered me a pay up, which is it's a weird, weird situation. The last day of the transfer window, they wanted me out to save money, but also, you know, they didn't think I was probably going to get the number one shirt. I weren't playing that great, or, you know, I hadn't even, again, I'd lost a bit of confidence. I didn't feel like a goalkeeper. At this point, I'd gone and had a game for MK Dons. But then this one day, someone rang me and said, no, Mowbray pulled me and said, look, do you want to play in a game for Ron Atkinson? He said, like, they've got a game, they're opening Shrewsbury Stadium. It's like a like All-Stars 11 versus Shrewsbury. So I was like, yep, I was rent a goalie. And this was me like lower than
rent-a-goalie.
Low.
Rent a goalie.
Yeah, lower than low. So I turned up, got on this bus, Ron Atkinson's there, like, hello son, you know, you're going to save us today because we've got a few old players, blah, blah, blah. Colton Palmer gets on the bus, Graham Lasso, Mickey Thomas. I'm like 22. I'm like, you know, young, fit, whatever. But I'm loving it. You know, like, I'm just full on, yep, I'll play for anyone.
Carlton get on, showtime. Yeah.
And then all of a sudden, everyone's on. Poyet plays. Poyet's on there. Some really good players. Fester, who's at Middlesbrough. I'm trying to remember the team. And then they're saying, oh, we're waiting for one more. And they're like, oh, where is he, the little Italian twat? And I'm like thinking, who is this? Like, who's going to come on? It was like, guess who's going to come on? And they're like, oh, he's just having his pasta and a smoke. On walk Zola. So Zola comes on the bus and I got to play with Gianfranco Zola for this game, and it was mental. Like, obviously he was chatting to us and, you know, he's already retired. And I was literally rent a goalie, and I was...
you're number two at a championship club and you've played in a...
Testimonial
to Open Shrewsbury Stadium. Yeah. And Zola's playing in.
Yeah, because it went from literally being number two to number three. And then they, in that January transfer window, the chairman wanted me out, Peace, whatever his name is.
Hiring you out to testimonials.
Yeah, I don't even know what I was doing, but honestly, I didn't know.
You
what
can
I was
say
doing.
You play with Zola, can't you?
Yeah.
I've had a game with Zola.
Yeah. And then out of nowhere, absolutely out of nowhere, that's it, I got offered a load of money to leave, right? And I was thinking of taking it and going, right, okay, I just want to get on with my career. My agent was saying, look, if you leave, take this money, tomorrow you'll wake up unemployed. It's hard for you to then get another club, blah, blah, blah. But it was a shitload of money. Like, you know,
your agent sounds shit on. Like, you said he was wank. I think it's the worst thing you could ever done.
Mate, I just went with it.
So, because obviously on the last day of the transfer window, if you leave that day, you can sign on a free to someone else. Yep. If you get paid up the day after the window, that you can't. So that's the reason why they offer you on the last day of the window.
Yeah.
Take the money, son. Take the money.
I know, but the next part would never have happened probably, because on a Wednesday, a random Wednesday in February, I got a call from Dan Ashworth, the technical director, and just said, look, do you want to go on loan to Barnsley for a month? We were in the Championship. So I was like, yeah, brilliant. I would have gone on loan to Starbucks FC or whatever, but, you know... I said, who's
you could have toured as a testimonial keeper.
Yeah. I was like, do you know what? This is no word of a lie. Again, to my agent, I rang him one time and just said, look, this is not working out. I've had no offers in January. West Brom don't want me. And I was thinking of changing positions then. I don't know why everyone laughs at that. Because right, I don't find it that funny, because I was actually serious and my agent was like, no, Luke, don't be so stupid. But in my head, I had it all mapped out. You know, I knew I could play a bit and I was, you know, I loved playing outfield. I was a midfielder back then in my head. And then I was really serious about it, really serious about it. I was going to change. And it was that week, that same week, I had that call and they said, go on loan to Barnsley. First game was at Anfield against Liverpool in the Cup. And, you know, after that, I kind of... got going. That was it. And then I've played in goal ever since, but
hey, come to Barnsley, we'll make your dreams come true. Yeah.
Barnsley saved me, and then I've, you know, we beat Liverpool on that Saturday and then end up playing the other games in that month, and then signed, well, I stayed 7 years.
Did you get your pay up when you went to Barnsley or not?
Yeah, that was a bit of, I had to pretend I weren't bothered and everyone paid a third and I lost a third.
Right.
Yeah. That's how it worked out. But it was all games. It was fun and games. Because you have to learn as a football player, you have to learn that side of it. Because then everyone says, oh, money's not important. But then you're presenting with, oh, yeah, you can go and play, but you're not getting that 100 grand or X amount. So then you have to at least have a go, which I did. And sometimes you get it, sometimes you don't. Sometimes you have to just slice a bit off the top. And I've learned so much. Again, going back to school, I didn't learn anything like numbers and how to negotiate, but through football I have. And I left and played that game, and somehow we got through to the semi-final.
That month, you come back with a bang there as well, didn't you, to that game at Anfield, and you man a match as well.
Yeah, it was just like one of those games.
How he scored.
Yeah, we were underdogs, and I didn't know the lads' names. We trained with them once. Did I feel confident? Think we were going to beat them? No way. I thought we were going to get smashed. I was thinking, don't let four in. I was thinking, get it at three and you'll be like, brilliant.
I'll take three.
Yeah,
I'll take three.
And you might be able to play the next league game. So the manager looked at me and I remember he was like, look, if you do well today and we get a result against Liverpool, I'll obviously keep you in the team. But they had another goalie.
Yeah.
Was so that I was Nick like, Colgan won it at that point?
No, it was Tony Warner. He'd come on loan from Fulham, but cup tied. And then, so everyone thought, he'll play one game and then go back after.
Did you see that as well? Did you see it as being a bit of a filling position? You didn't see yourself being there for 7 years?
No, I didn't know I'd be there for 7 years, but I just, one thing at a time. It was that Liverpool game. I was hyped. And they talk about the training kicks in. I was so nervous. Didn't have any confidence of winning the game. Didn't have any confidence playing well.
You've not played for a while. Yeah, exactly. I imagine.
That's what I mean, though. It doesn't sound like your mentality is, I'm going to go to Barnsley on this loan, I'm going to take the number one position, and I'm going to become the number one goalkeeper at Barnsley.
No. Thing is, the alternative was turn up for the flipping All-Stars. Oh, yeah. that's still a better option, even if you're number two at Barnsley.
But I didn't go with any confidence, but I was prepared to have a go. And then if you train hard enough and the repetition, when it comes on the main stage and you're nervous, that kicks in. That's why they say train hard and do all the rest of it, because when you are in those situations, it all just flowed and it was like a dream. And I think I had 23 shots to save, you know, and then one play of the round. I was on the BBC in the next morning. Everything changed again for me. So from being right down there, I was like in the limelight. I was in all the papers and, you know,
thrived on the confidence.
Yeah, and then I played the next game at Norwich and then I kept my position. They got rid of Tony Warner, and then I played to the end of the season, obviously stayed in the league, and you know, we beat Chelsea in the next round 1-0. I didn't have much to do actually, but you know, I'm carried off the pitch, and that's how quick you can turn around from playing with like veterans.
Yeah.
Old men. Who didn't know who I was. Yeah, I remember Mickey Thomas saying to me, I swear, he said to me and my dad at the end of that game, that he said, you're decent, you know, you're a good goalkeeper, Luke. Have you got, like, you should think about going professional. I swear my life. And I was at West Brom and I was like, I am, like, you know, I'm like so modest and that. I've kind of got a contract to West Brom. And Poyet was the same. Poyet was talking to my dad saying, yeah, your son's still got a chance, you know, you should get him into a professional club, because there was basically all these vets and then there was two or three young players, but one professional, but a few like young players who could run a bit. So that's how quick you can turn around. So like, you can knock your confidence to the floor and then somehow you can be flying high a few weeks later.
There's no bigger accolade in football than doing the main interview on the Barnsley Chronicle on the Friday, is there? Yeah. You know what I mean?
How did you enjoy moving to the metropolis?
It was brilliant. It was just such a good time. I always think of those first few weeks when I didn't know anybody and all this mayhem about the cup. You know, we beat Chelsea, lightning struck twice, we beat Chelsea and we're at Wembley. You know, it was amazing. I've never played at Wembley since. It was all going great. And then I signed for them and yeah, had about 6-7 seasons virtually playing all the time.
What about the High Street?
The High Street.
The Barnsley.
I was just having a look then. What year did you sign, Steele?
You won't get any negativity about Barnsley from me, mate. So,
what year did you sign?
2008.
Ibiza.
Ibiza. It's probably just teaching off the Ibiza then.
Yeah. A bit more.
Did you see it when there's like the wine bar where you can drink on the street outside and all that?
What, in the square? Yeah, walkabout.
No, when you go down the way and then you chuck a right and it's like a bar with tables and you dance on there. So you just missed out on Ibiza then.
You're talking Magaluf now.
Yeah. All I knew that I got an apartment for £490 a month, which was the cheapest I've ever heard of.
Nine bedroom apartment.
with the butler.
So what the manager who signed you at Barnsley?
Simon Davey. Yeah. Who I nearly had a fight with actually the next year, because I was in the team till the end of the season. Then the next year, the goalie was injured, Heinz Müller, got back. He played him. He played me to begin with, and I was playing all right. He played, then he dropped me. And again, I was like sub for a good few months, like half the season, most of the season. And I was like, you know, thinking, oh, blown it. I only had a 1 year deal, but I was thinking I should be playing. I thought that I was doing well enough to be playing. He wasn't playing well, basically. And one day at a game, I think he named the team, and I just was drinking a bottle of water. And this is out of character. I just dropped that water and I'd had enough. I was like, and then at the end of the game, he started saying stuff about me. And I just lost the plot. Probably a couple of times in my whole career I've done that. I've lost the plot. And I am going, all my emotion, all my like, because I train hard. I train like, do everything well. And I was going mental at this manager. Didn't care about what, and you know, I was prepared to fight
him. Not the consequences were irrelevant.
Irrelevant. Absolute red mist. I was stood up. Nobody could control me. And he kind of then obviously had to come back and, you know,
show his authority.
But I was all in. I was all in. And I remember we got about that close and didn't. And I, you know, I'm 23. I'm not like old or. And
you think about the old Rob Page right up.
Yeah. I remember end up being down in the gym afterwards crying, but thinking, I'm going to give Mickey Thomas a call. Yeah, but then to be fair to him, a few weeks later, they had four games to go and he put me back in the team. And then I obviously helped us stay in the league, last day at Plymouth. And then after that, he gave me a 2 year deal. So, yeah.
Rob Kozluk there.
Yeah, funny guy, Rob Kozluk. Nicked the FA Cup. Yeah, they came when we beat Chelsea. They obviously made a big thing of it. And I don't know if you ever see the two guys that bring the FA Cup, they travel with it. They got the suits and the top hats. Real secure. Obviously, we're going to have pictures with it. Straight away, Rob Kozluk just grabs it, runs around the training ground. I've got it. He was class. He was brilliant character.
Prankster, we've heard.
Yeah, he's a prankster.
Some place though, Barnsley, isn't it?
Yeah, it's like my family loved the place. Like, because, you know, for 6-7 years, they came to watch. It's just got so much about it without the razzmatazz, do you know what I mean?
We're just simple folk, aren't we?
Yeah, there's no Starbucks or Costa. I don't know if they've introduced
that. Oh, there is now, mate.
Oh, is there?
Yeah. Oh, don't worry about that.
They weren't back in the day.
They've got a Taco Bell now. Yeah.
Yeah, we have actually. We've got a Taco Bell. Honestly, all my cons. They've done it all out, to be fair. All the market and everything. Right, okay. Like a bull ring, it's called, I think.
Right.
You know, like upstairs in the old market.
Yeah.
That's all fucking bars and everything there.
Flipping heck.
Why did you move to Leeds then?
Just got bored really. Just had about 3 or 4 years and moved to Leeds to have a bit of fun. Yeah, to live in the city centre of Leeds. So I lived all around there really. I was only there for a couple of years, but Barnsley's one of them. Every season it was like we needed to stay up.
Yeah.
We were lowest paid. We knew we were most seasons.
But enjoying it.
Hey?
But enjoying it.
Yeah, I loved it. I always had little offers to go elsewhere. And again, it was like those in-between offers where I knew I weren't really going to be playing. And this is when money really I didn't care about that. I really wanted to be happy because I'd had the, you know, the big clubs and or the bigger clubs and like a bit more money. But then I was at Barnsley. I was appreciated. I was number one. You know, I became captain. Yeah, captain in the end, which meant everything to me. I've always said that when they gave me that, you know, I felt so much pride and even more passion for the club, and I really fell in love with it. Like I fell in love with the club, like, and it's great if that ever happens. I don't know whether that's happened to you guys as a footballer.
No.
But if you fall in love with the club, it's like a little bit like how I said I wanted to improve everything. I wanted the groundsman to be like to get the pitch better and things like that. And I was like all in. I was balls deep. Barnsley was my club. That was it.
Balls deep in Barnsley.
Yeah.
there's a few I've been.
That's what your video would be called.
Yeah.
That's refreshing though to hear that, because I mean, there's not, like you said, not many players get to that point where, or have that mentality of really enjoying and, like you said, falling in love with the club and getting better offers to go elsewhere.
Yeah, that's a big thing.
And wanting to stay.
Yeah, no, I remember Fulham offering me a deal. I think Schwartz was still there. But I just knew I weren't going to play. And I was like, this is one of them slippery roads where then you don't play and blah, blah, blah. And I wanted to get to 10 years. I always wanted to be at a club for 10 years. Didn't quite happen, but like, I was loving it. I got loads of managers a sack, obviously, but you know, that's part of football.
Do you like Keith Hill?
Yeah, he was all right.
Like some of his kind of inspirational talks that maybe don't quite hit the spot.
Yeah, he's raw. He's really raw. His language is a bit, you know, old school, but he was more of a motivator, you know. He had Vaz Tay, a lad at West Ham. And I like telling numbers because I think it's quite relevant, but he was on £500 a week at Barnsley. He had a dodgy knee. By November, December, he'd scored 12, 13 goals for like a mid-table average team. And we sold him in the January. I can't remember how much they sold him for. Yeah, we might have got... No, I think we sold him for £500,000 because he was only on a year contract. And he went on... 20 grand a week and then scored the winner that same season at Wembley to go to Premier League. So then I think he went to like 30 grand a week. So like within less than a year, he went from £500, dodgy knee, couldn't pass a medical, scoring the winner. Obviously, I think it was double bubble or something like that, but he was on a lot of money. It might even be more than that, but...
Playing the Premier League. Highs and lows, what you were saying about playing for the All-Stars.
Yeah.
He's gone through the same, hasn't he?
Exactly, Chris. But Keith Hill was so intense with him, caned him, you know, but he bought into it that he was struggling. So that's why if you get a struggling player, sometimes it's the best ones to have because they're desperate, you know. And to have that change around is like one hell of a season.
Mm. But it's not like there's not many other industries where it can literally change like that. You know what I mean? He's gone from 25 grand a year to well over 25 grand per week.
Mm. Yeah.
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 There's not many other industries where that can happen, is
there? It can't. And that's why it brings all the other stuff like, you know, the problems, the addictions and things like that. Because when you're high, it's great. When you're low, your mentality can change so quickly. And it might be that you're on the same money, but something else you're not playing or you're injured and people are down the Swanee.
Yeah.
It's happened more and
unless you're doing an American gangster and going straight to the top, man.
Always.
To get your support.
Yeah.
Is it worth me joining that JJB, Jimmy Barber, by the way? Is it put nice pool area and whatever? And
to get you some discount.
Ring Dave.
You've got his number. Out. Dave. Yeah. Dave, I used to play a little bit and any chance I can get in.
Remember your Christmas do in Leeds?
Yeah.
That gear crashed.
Yeah, probably.
Your gear crashed at mine once in Newcastle.
Did I?
You're just going on all different Christmas days.
I think I was out on a Sunday and I didn't know you were there. I've just come out of the toilets in this bar in Jesmond and he's laid on a sofa, like a booth. Like, you know, when he gets sleepy, don't he? After a few, he's like half asleep. I was like, that's party in Newcastle on a Sunday night at like 6 o'clock, asleep. I hadn't seen you for probably 2 or 3 years before, like since I'd seen you.
Yeah, before this, we started with this, weren't it?
Yeah.
And best 2 or 3 years of my life, that.
But he was full. He'd had enough lag. You know when he's done.
Yeah.
So I hadn't seen him in years. Within 2 minutes, we're going for an all-you-need Chinese.
Got a little pick-me-up for about half an hour. Yeah, one more bar, and then I were done it again.
Full chicken.
Yeah. But you were bottom of the league, but Barnes are near the bottom, looking like you're getting relegated. You organised this Christmas do in Leeds, wasn't it?
Yeah, because I live there.
You took the rate. You organised it all.
Yeah, that was again one of my greatest achievements.
Yeah,
just under the Ronaldo bit. But we were bottom of the league, great escape year, blah blah blah. We were rock bottom. I think the furthest away from your safety that anyone had been on. And like we had this Christmas do, and again we didn't have a big pot of fine money, but I organised it. But what I did is I stripped all the furniture from my apartment, which was the city centre of Leeds, and kind of moved it upstairs. So I kind of made a big disco room and things. So everything was on a budget. Living room we went to, organise a party. I was single at the time, obviously. I must have invited every girl that I knew within the Yorkshire, Manchester area, you know, like, and got everyone there and had this Christmas doing. It was great. And we spent hardly anything, but we had a great night. I got glassed actually on my arm. That is
great
a night. And like my whole arm was blue and black, but it weren't his fault. He didn't mean to. And that saved us, I think, that Christmas day. Not the immense effort after Christmas.
I hope some of the wives aren't listening or lads were in that dressing room.
Yeah, but.
Yeah, it was shit, Leeds. It was shit. We should have gone somewhere else.
Yeah.
Steele's house. We were having this fucking party at Steele's house. It was shit.
It was brilliant.
Yeah. You used to get invited to random things, random openings of like different rooms or something. We went to the living room one day and there was people giving massages. You remember that one?
Oh, speed dating. We went speed dating.
What, you and Jim did?
I don't know if you did, me and Chris, but like I remember going, we knew the guy who owned it and he said that there's this speed dating thing. So we went up to the top and there was like literally, I think you got 2 minutes to speak and then they go ting and then you move around.
How did it go?
Like it wasn't me, but you were...
Fuck off.
I was in a relationship at the time.
My ex-missus doesn't watch this, I don't think, but... You were judging Mr. Leeds Gear UK or summer.
Mr. Leeds.
Oh, shit.
What was it?
Were you a boy about town there in Leeds?
No, it wasn't. But when I get injured, John, like, I try not gamble, I try not drink, don't do drugs, but I've got an addictive thing. So, like, I'll socialise. And at that point, I think I got a little injury. It was my back, actually. It came back. I didn't... Why have you mentioned this?
Had to be brought up.
Mate, I literally had this in my head. I was thinking, there's no way, because there's a picture as well. Basically, I was a judge on Mr. Gay UK 2012. But
Did you look for in a good specimen?
Just like a tight ass and
chiseled.
Someone who's nice, got a bit of character. Yeah,
but did they speak in that? Were they like,
yeah,
like
it was a massive dude. It was a massive dude, thousands of people. It's the biggest one in the UK. A guy called Terry George, he runs it. I said no. And then on the night, I remember going out and had a few drinks. And I was very like, I'm very open in terms of like, you know, that doesn't bother me at all. I had a few gay friends. The guy lived, who ran living rooms gay, and I had a few gay friends, still have now. And I just thought, yeah, I'll do it. You know, on the night, it caught me on a good moment, a bit like my electrician.
He's in a good mood, go and ask him.
Yeah. And he said, I said, yeah, go on then, I'll do it. And I was up there presenting, bimming this, that and whatever, choosing like the guy to the best of my ability. And yeah, it was in the papers and the websites. And my mum actually sent me the next day saying, what are you doing? Like, you know.
Is there a blueprint? Like this is what we're looking for. We're looking for nice eyes, chiseled frame, firm buttocks, personality, done some charity work.
Barry Fry-esque tan.
World peace, all that sort of stuff. Yeah, they were basically half naked, but it was done on like looks, personality, things like that. So I don't even know how I got into this, but it was just one of the nights. I was steaming up on stage in front of thousands of gay guys, just like
you
mad
must have been,
for it.
You must have been like fresh meat, were you?
I don't know.
You get him
I can't remember a lot from that night. It's weird.
You'd ring us and do you fancy going to the opening to an art gallery in Leeds City Centre?
Because you've got to get out there, you've got to socialise. And when you sat there doing nothing all the time, but did you not enjoy it? Like getting out there, meeting people.
Yeah.
Meeting people away from football.
You did introduce us to a lot of good people.
Football used to bore me so much I think you're the same when you played in that. I couldn't get involved watching Sky Sports all the time. I needed to stimulate my mind with something else. So whatever's on my doorstep, I kind of thought, right, I need to attack this. That's the reason I moved to Leeds, because I was going a bit insane with like the repetition and all the rest of it, which is why I ended up moving to Greece. One of the big reasons, because I was like, you know, I need something else. I need a new challenge. Yeah.
Variety.
So yeah, that's what it was. So I used to drag Chris to art galleries and, you know, openings and stuff, beauty pageants,
things like that. But that was probably my best time living in Leeds.
Yeah.
Because we used to join Virgin, didn't we? You supported Richard. Got us a membership. But we did. We used to have Virgin on a night and there was a fancy Nando's. And then Alchemist. We just go for a couple of pints in the Alchemist on a random Wednesday.
Yeah.
And we're both, on the pitch, we're both doing well.
Happy.
We weren't living the best. We were living terribly, in fact.
I wouldn't say terribly. I'd say the alcohol, but like diet and all the rest of it, we were on it. We'd go to the gym, we're doing all the extras, and it was working.
Yeah.
So how did it come about leaving Barnsley then? You were happy there?
Yeah, I was happy there. We got relegated in the last season, which is... I was injured for a few months there. Jack Butland came in and filled in while I was away. And then I came back and my back was really sore. Like, that was another time. It's weird because it was Sheffield again. I went to see a specialist and he was like, look, you're not going to be that player who plays many years longer if you even get back from this injury. So I thought the stress fracture had opened up again. So there's two tiny little bones, L5, which is on your lumbar. And when they come away from each other, obviously it's excruciating. But mine had been, you know, all these years of damage. had obviously taken its toll. And yeah, I got back and we got relegated. I was devastated because we had a push at the end, but we weren't right. The players we had weren't right. They were like some talented lads, and we had Liam Lawrence and Paddy McCourt, Woodsy, you know, but we just didn't get going. I was gutted because we could have stayed up that year.
You're missing one that springs to mind straight away.
Oh.
Frimpong.
Frimpong. Am I saying that right? Frimpong.
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 Frimpong. Emmanuel Frimpong. Yeah. From Arsenal.
There. Frimpong.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, he was there.
I can imagine he didn't tech to the Barnsley's lifestyle.
Mate, he had no idea. No clue. He came from Arsenal, you know, but he was like fully Arsenal, like London, you know, Arsenal. He came to Barnsley and he didn't get it. But he was this weird guy. I remember asking him the first few days, I was like, all right, so you were at Arsenal, how long you signed for us for? Because I knew he'd signed properly. And like, he was like, yeah, I've kind of signed it, but I'm connected with Arsenal still. Like, and I was like, what do you mean?
In denial.
Like, this is honest to God. And he was like telling me that, yeah, but I'm kind of like, I'm here, I'm at Barnsley, but I'm only like, I'm part of Arsenal still.
So you were absolute ball, man.
Mate, you would not believe it. It's like
his wife's kicked him out, and,
yeah,
but and he doesn't want to leave.
I'm still
he's
married.
Like, yeah, but like we're still together.
Like
kind of. She's got Gardner in.
It's like Trump at minute, isn't it? Yeah, I'm still president. I'll be president in 6 months. I'm still president. Yeah. I know I'm not the president at the minute, but I will be in 6 months. Yeah. I'm still affiliated with it.
Yeah, that's what he was like.
Donald Frimpong.
That could be a great wind-up from Wenger, though, couldn't it?
If it's gone.
Wenger just said, yeah, go to Barnsley, but you can come back.
Yeah,
come back, see the kids.
Chris Eagles was like that at United. He couldn't let it go. He was like, yeah, I'm at Burnley, but basically Man, you're buying me back soon.
Buyback clause.
Yeah, for next 10 years. But like Frimpong was like that. He couldn't let go. He'd been at Arsenal and he was like, yeah, I'm going to go back to Arsenal. And I was like, I've read it online. You're part of Barnsley now. Like,
is he an English fella?
Ghanaian or something?
But but he's lived here.
Is he? Yeah, from England. Like?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Speaks with a London accent, but he's, he's on a different planet. But that's why it's hard. It's hard. I was always scared of that, leaving a big club and going, because you can only go like to smaller clubs really from United and Arsenal and places like that. But I was always scared of being that twat who, you know, was always talking about
clinging
United.
On.
I think that that first loan year at Coventry helped you with that when you went back.
Yeah, that.
You know, I know what I'm letting myself in for, if you know what I mean.
Yeah,
dropping down the way.
Definitely.
Even though you're only dropping a league, in fact, you're dropping a long way, aren't you? From Man U even to another Premier League team, you're still dropping down a long way, aren't you?
Yeah, but you've got to. That's why you've got to have not intelligence, but you've got to know, like, be aware of what's going on. You've got to recognise that the Ben Fosters, the Van der Sar's are better than you. Frimpong.
Got to be a realist at times, aren't you?
Yeah, you've got to be a realist. Like, it's, and I feel so sorry for some players that don't see it that way, and it's the pride. It's the pride that I think flipping it, you're way off it. You might not even be a League Two player, but it's going to be a long old road.
Yeah.
The wind up brought him back down to earth, though, didn't it? Can we talk about that?
The wind up? What
on
one?
Frimpong.
Which one?
When, didn't somebody pretend to be a girl?
Oh, flipping heck, yeah. That's a good one. That's cringy. But so basically, he'd signed and he was a bit of a, like, he was a nice enough lad, but he was full of shit. I think his cousin was like, his cousin was a rapper.
Yes.
The rapper Bizzle.
Yeah, because he was on the music video.
Bizzle Frimmy
was on the
Lethal Bizzle or something like that.
Yeah. You know it, like Lethal a big Bizzle. Rapper. What's his name?
Is it not Lethal Bizzle?
Lethal Bizzle.
Yeah.
That was it. Yeah, so he was always going on
Sounds
about
scary.
That.
Scary.
You would have tore him to pieces, John. Honestly, you would have tore him to pieces. But he, one of the lads, because he didn't have anyone's number, one of the lads pretended to be a bird, sending him like messages saying, oh, I'm so-and-so, and started using the girl. I think this is illegal now, but it probably was then. But, you know, sending pictures to say, oh, you know, I saw you and you play for Barnsley, I've got your number off so-and-so. Obviously, he started replying dirty messages, pictures and things like that.
Has and it went to picture his one word?
The full Monty. The full Monty and everything. And it was horrible because I'm one of them was going, oh, just stop it, please, blah, blah, blah. And then it got to the stage where, I think this is Jim O'Brien, they made the montage onto like the big screen. We got him in one morning and they said, look, we're going to go through set pieces on the big screen. Oh. And they had all the messages, the pictures of the pipe and everything.
How did he take it?
He took it all right, but it was terrible. It was hard. It was one of the best because we did it properly. The video analysis guy got involved. Do you know what I mean? It was a proper presentation. The whole point. Yeah.
You just got to hold your hands up, I think, haven't you?
Yeah, I think he did, to be fair. I think he took it really well, as far as I remember. But yeah, that was one of the worst. That was like a poor...
Impressive one wood on Frimpong.
Not bad, to be fair.
Yeah.
I can give any positives for any...
If there's anybody got experience.
Any women watching or anything, he's fine. Do you know what I mean?
Do a job.
Yeah.
Just not a fucking right back or whatever position he were.
We played just... And obviously I knew about him. I think you were telling us about him, what he was like. So for the full 90 minutes, I was just trying to get a bite from him, just leaving one on him randomly. And
yeah.
But halfway through the game, I thought, he's actually sound. Because it wasn't phasing him. He'd have a little smile and whatever. So after the game, I went over, and you don't know this. I said, oh, Steve, he said you're a dick, but you're actually all right. So if he was a bit off with you after, then you blame me.
So I'm going to Google him after, because I want to know what his career looked like.
I messaged him to see if he'd come on, but I think he's still got thinking about nightmares. The wind-up.
Yeah.
So you don't know his number?
Nah.
we had so many people coming at Barnsley. Obviously, they were getting trialists in all the time from all over the world, really. But, you know, they were trying to nick a freebie player and things like that. It was great. Just like every week, you'd have like someone new come in, or, you know, an old pro that you'd not seen in years. It was class. It was just, you know, roll in, roll off.
Paddy McCourt.
Paddy McCourt.
He came out with us, didn't he, one night?
Yeah, big drinker, but... talented guy, didn't love football enough, really. He was, you know, if you want a good watch on YouTube, watch his best goals, because he was phenomenal. But the worst trainer, terrible body, flipping their cover.
The body, Lewis.
No, I'm not renowned for having a great, like...
He's just a Mr. Gear competition. He thinks he knows fucking perfect for it. Jesus, fucking Simon Cowell and fucking Gear beauty pageant.
Yeah.
I think he poured a full pint of Guinness over his head.
Yeah, he was up
there. Ruin a shirt, that, innit?
I think drinking, like alcohol, you know, especially in teams like that, there's nothing wrong with it. I will stick by that. You know, I do understand all the professionalism that's come into the game, but some of it has got ridiculous.
Yeah.
I'm not big on physiotherapy and things like that. I wouldn't even mention it to clubs that I've been at. I just... you know, if they were ever to listen, I never go in there because I didn't believe in the machines, the biscuit tin, all the thing. I think it's crap. The only thing I like is a chiropractor, but some of the stuff that football clubs do is crazy, like staying overnight before games. That was a big thing for the last 3 or 4 years of my career so far. Load of crap.
But games, like
home games, I'm talking about, yeah. But the hotels I hate. I've got a condition where I don't sleep very well. I'm calling it a condition, but it's just... you know, a minor thing, but I've been known to take fire exits apart. Any sounds that I can hear, I'm complaining. I'm going knocking on doors because I can't sleep with any noise, even now. But that's why I hated it.
You'd be no good in a room with either of us two.
Yeah.
Mate. You know, you get the itchy top of your mouth, he's like that. When I need sleep.
I know. I've slept with him a few times.
Yeah. I just thought about you dismantling a fire exit. Alan Partridge came to mind when he'd done the trouser press. Took the trouser press apart.
Alan Partridge.
You're surrounded by parts in the morning.
So you used to room on your own then at away games? Or?
Well, Barnsley wouldn't pay for that. So I had a roommate a lot of the time. But yeah, after that, when I went to Greece, I roomed on my own a lot.
Because you could pay the difference, couldn't you?
Yeah, you can pay the difference, which is extortionate, but... I had to do it, really.
So the good night's sleep weren't worth the extra 150 quid for the hotel?
Nah, probably not. I would have had a better career if I'd done that earlier on, but yeah.
So could you leave on a free when Barnsley got relegated?
Yeah, well, actually, I had it in my contract that if I was to get relegated, I could leave on a free, which they accepted, which actually worked in my favour then. But
have you still got another year left?
Yeah, I've got another year left. So we got relegated under Flitcroft. And I was just a bit stale. I don't think I was playing the best I could, but I needed another challenge, Chris. I just said to my agent, I can't believe he's getting so much coverage, by the way.
I'm not going to say his name. Right.
Yeah, he's terrible. But he produced because I said, look, I need another challenge. I need to play abroad. I want to play abroad. I said, I can play with my feet, but no one's seen it at Barnsley for 7 years now. So it's my best attribute playing out. I said, but the only way I'm going to do that is to play abroad. I didn't think I was better than Barnsley or the Championship, but I just wanted to play a different way. You know, you go pre-season, it's like everyone's ticky-tacky, everyone's watched the World Cup, everyone's playing out from the back. First game of season every year, Barnsley, boom, boom, boom.
Yeah, yeah.
So then somehow he got speaking to clubs abroad, let them know that I was up for going away. And Panathinaikos came in for me. And I had a meeting down in London with Dabizas, who wanted to look me in the eyes. And that's a Greek.
So the kid who were at Newcastle?
Yeah, yeah. Bergkamp did that weird thing around him.
So what was his role?
He was technical director, sporting director, sorry.
Yeah.
So yeah, they all have him abroad. But he came, looked me in the eyes and said like, yeah, you know, you're the one. And I signed a 2-year deal there. I was
chatting. Sounds like it's one of your speed days.
There you go, Nico. Give us a call, eh?
I'm going to let the manager off this one. They're not coming to speak to me. Yeah. I'm happy with the sporting director this one.
Yeah. And that was me. I was with my mates in the apartment. And then got a shout saying, look, there's a plane, they booked your ticket tomorrow morning, go and have a look at the place, maybe have a, you know, talk to them. And again, I end up going, flying the next morning, spoke to the manager, flew the next morning, and I trained, I think, 48 hours after, and that was it. I was in the squad for the next game.
Are you married, kids, at this time?
No, I was single.
Right.
I just split up from a girl in Leeds, and I was single, so that made it even better, like, because it was timing.
Yeah.
You know, I didn't have any kids. I was 29 and that was it. Bam, I signed a 2-year deal, not on particularly good money, which is very important because, you know, a lot of people said, oh, he must be on great money there, blah, blah, blah. But huge club, like, which Panathinaikos is, they weren't blessed with a lot of cash at the time. And they offered me a, you know, similar to what I was on at Barnsley, but I think it was a tiny bit less when I worked it out. And yeah, I ended up signing a 3-year deal after the first season. So I got like, you know, then I got a really good contract, but you know, I went to just for an adventure.
It's all about the experience.
All about the experience, the adventure. It's what I wanted. I wanted to be in the deep end. I wanted to be nervous again, which I was, like on the plane thinking, flipping it.
What am I doing?
You know, went to do the medical and signed that next day, I think. So
there's not many English lads do it, is there?
No.
Take the plunge of going abroad, yeah, especially considering you've manufactured that move, haven't you?
Yeah.
You've said, I want to go abroad.
Yeah.
Well, I think it's the opportunity as well,
yeah,
as much as anything. I don't think I ever had an opportunity to go abroad.
But that's what I'm saying. Luke's manufactured it himself. I want to go abroad and play abroad. Find me a club abroad.
Yeah. And it's all right doing that, but you've probably got the biggest club. Well, what them and Olympiacos, the biggest clubs in Greece. You know, yeah, like we've had Liam Lawrence on, who went to probably fourth or fifth. Yeah. But I remember I went up to see you. And you were playing away, and you left as the king. So I just go to the sports bar, every single telly, big Panathinaikos game, loads of fans in the pub. I'm thinking, fuck me, this is a proper club. You know, like probably equivalent to Man U and that over here.
Was it an eye-opener when you got there, in terms of, especially like the ultras and the fans, how enthusiastic they are? And
yeah, I mean, I loved every minute of it from having a medical and the doctor, because it's all about the rivalry there. So like the derby games are everything. And obviously Olympiacos is that's the derby of eternal enemies. So they always say that'll be forever. And the doctor who was doing my medical, he was doing a heart scan. I was going through all these bits and bobs. He was a stern looking Greek guy, didn't speak a word to me the whole time, just like, and then like he was doing, and he looked at me at the end of this. This is on the, you know, the first few hours. And there I'm straight away to a medical. My agent's doing the contract, things like that. And I'm trying to say stuff to him. And he's like muttering away. And then it finished. He was like, okay, close on, blah, blah, blah. And then he looked at me and said, fuck Olympiacos. And like, I was like, right, okay.
Do you think it was a bird that they'd sorted out for you? Just a little sweetener. Yeah, we've got a bird here. She's called Olympiacos. Fuck her.
And I was
just
like,
little sweetener, fuck Olympiacos.
Yeah, they're not gonna like me saying that, but that's how it was. But it was all about that. If your family was one or the other, then that was it. You were green or red, and it was either you see all around Athens number 7, which is gate 7 for Olympiacos, or ours, which is green, gate 13. So that's the actual gate, but that is it. Gate 7, gate 13.
Geared for what?
Well, they were the ultras, so that they're all called ultras, like their main people. But gate 13 was actually the gate they all came in behind one of the goals for our place and one of the the goals at their place, but that was the ultras. But the whole experience, just again, it was like I was in it. I was like in a movie, you know, like yeah. I was going around places, like looking at apartments and on like near the beach and near the sea. It was red hot. It was like late 30s. We had Standard Liège in a few weeks straight away in a Champions League qualifier. It was, you know, obviously the home games, it was like electric, like fireworks and crackers going off. And, you know, the press, the media, they think it's bad here. It's just like, they're like on you. That when you're doing a welcome speech, you have to do a speech. Like, I don't know if you see it, a lot of the foreign clubs do it. But like, all these things, you have to then address yourself to the people, to the media and to the fans and say, hi, I'm really pleased to be here. You know, thanks for the opportunity and things like that. And I was loving it because I was like, just, right, okay, what's this? I had a translator, what's this? And everything was like just going on. That was it. That was me. I was addicted.
So did you embrace the culture, learn the language?
Yeah. We had a Dutch coach and he was like, you've got to have lessons. So I had lessons 2-3 times a week. You know, there's a few other players having the lessons and, you know, I just got involved. Said yes to everything. Got another tutor who kind of did extra lessons. And then...
really? She knows.
I don't even know why I'm laughing. And then, you know, I was fully up for, you know, embracing the club and stuff like that. And again, I've really like fell for the club. The passion and the difference to England is crazy. But, you know, luckily I got in the team. That's obviously a big part. I forgot after one or two games, the keeper who'd like been playing, he got dropped. I got put in. I was playing all these friendly games. That was it. I was always playing friendlies. I got 7 1-0 wins in a row for friendly games. Then I got in the first team and we kept winning 1-0, 1-0. And that was me. I was off and running. And it makes such a difference when you start off at a club well, because, you know, it's the first impression kind of thing and you do well. And that was it. I think in the November, I was playing at PSV in the Europa League. So, because we missed out on Champions League, so we go into Europa League. So, you know, I was there, Philip Cocu was the manager, but I was there at PSV all of a sudden, thrown into the deep end in the Europa League. And you're not sure, again, I didn't think I could play Europa League football. I know it's like, it doesn't sound...
Is goalkeeper not just, like, you're getting a shot, even if you're a goalkeeper in League Two, is the shot different in the Premier League or the Europa League? It's still the same shot, isn't it?
Not the shot, to be honest. It's more like the way you play, because we have total football, by the way. We're total football from the
right
back.
Right off street, being a frustrated striker.
Yeah. But, you know, again, like the crossing and, you know, it's just the mental part of it. Like you think everything's going to be bigger and better. But again, I threw myself into it and, you know, we drew 1-1 that game. My dad was in the crowd at PSV and, it, you know, we've gone from playing in the championship at Barnsley and then we're in the Europa League, getting a draw at PSV. It was class. It was just what I wanted. And that I was reborn. I was really like, I was in love with the game. I was like looking at this, looking at that. And that was me.
Did you thrive off, you know, how fanatical they are over there? Was that just a completely different, obviously, to what you've played out?
Mate, in the first season, I think we had a few bad results. And I heard in the change room one morning at training that the ultras are coming. So I was like, what do you mean the ultras are coming, like here? And this is like the manager came into the change room, says, look, everyone stay quiet. The ultras are coming. The dab has asked everyone, like the main guys were there. I think the president was there. So the president basically is the guy who owns a club, not of the country. But the ultras turned up 50 strong, all on motorbikes, the roughest looking lads you've ever seen. Green, you know, the ultras and stuff. Might have had a firework or like a flare. And the guy put, like, they have a leader. So it's all military style. They have a leader. He was intimidating. Really intimidating. He had man wrists. And, like, he would then proceed to address the team. Either say, I think it was more of a good luck one, that one. Or, come on, we're like Panathinaikos. And, like, they get in your face. The president was shushed. The hushed. The manager wouldn't say a thing. There's 50 of them surround, like a circle. And we'd all have just to listen. That happened the first time and I was playing well at that time, really enjoyed it. But it happened again in the third year when we were having a really bad time. I think we'd got knocked out of Europe. That was it. We didn't qualify for the Europa League. We drew to Kabbalah, who was like quite I think from Afghanistan, not Afghanistan, Azerbaijan. And we went out and they came and they roughed us up. They came out onto the training ground.
What?
I physically roughed the captain, Zeka, who like they grabbed him by the shirt. This is like, and you can't do anything. Obviously, he's kind of not fighting back, but he's having a bit. I'm kind of grabbing him, but they mean business. They're going mental. They're going nuts. But that's what they do.
I push and shove him.
Yeah. But like intimidating stuff, like, you know, a few.
Next level, man, isn't it?
Yeah, a few like digs as well.
So
digs at us and saying, look, you know, obviously it's in Greek and English and Greek and English, but that blew my mind. Absolutely blew my mind. But the first time it happened, I loved it. So that was another part. I wanted to be part of stuff like that and made me feel their passion. They're like, that was their life. It was their complete life. All the money went on the games, traveling. You turn up at hotels and you get on the, like at 10, 11 o'clock at night, day before a game. And there'd be like fans all around the entrance of the hotel with flares and singing the songs and
felt like it mattered.
Smoke bombs.
You should have said to the main guy, look, honestly, I'm not good at sleeping. You just tell him to put them fireworks out there. I'll have a much better game tomorrow.
Did it feel like it mattered?
Oh,
do you think that's why
it mattered so much? Yeah, it mattered so much. And it was more about the, if you gave the right performance, they knew that Olympiacos had a stronger budget. In the first year, we just missed out on winning the league. And I think we got deducted points and banned. Our fans got banned a lot. And like that meant the repercussions of that would be playing with no fans for two or three games. So that was a real poor part of it. But it mattered. Everything mattered. And like you said, you'd go to a bar, a cafe, where I kind of got to know people, like little cafes. And if you didn't play well or you lost, had a bad result or drew against a poor team, they'd treat you differently. They'd be like, they're very like, they come across very rude. You know, you're talking about right that side of Europe. So you're looking at Cyprus. If they can come across, the Turks are very similar, very rude. And like, it's, you know, they're like, oh, still, because you've played bad or whatever. That's how it is, you know.
See, that what's made Barnsley so good, mate. You can get Dick 4-0 at home, mate. You can hit Wellington Street and you know you still get Lexeter.
That's what I was meaning before, like talking about Peterborough, like the contrast in terms of that being a business. And then you're there and how emphatical everybody is, like, this matters, every game matters.
Yeah.
And it's more about playing and winning.
Yeah, you're representing, it's harder for a keeper because you can't give more effort than in one game than another, but they wanted to be represented as people. Like, they didn't have a different religion to the rivals, but they had like an identity. So they wanted to be represented as like, never give up, full effort, play with a bit of like, pinnace, like, you know, like they wanted to have like, an identity.
A little bit.
Yeah, but if you didn't give that, you'd get hell. You'd get hell. And that's when social media was like, I just opened an account when I went to Greece. And, you know, it's great when you're playing well. It's like all these plaudits. And, like, you know, they've got 3 million fans, apparently, Panathinaikos around the world. But then he played bad. And it's like, dog's abuse. Absolute dog's abuse. Really is.
Did you ever worry about, sort of when we've heard stories, did you ever worry about, like, not getting paid? Or did you ever not get paid? Or
I didn't. When I first went there, I didn't, because I thought it's Panathinaikos. They got to semi-final Champions League a few years ago and, you know, they're a huge club. But I didn't realise, because obviously I went there and the first year I went there was that big crisis across Europe.
Right.
Where Greece obviously owed all that money and the country was in crisis. So then things started getting tough. But even then I thought, oh, our guy, he owns Sky TV or whatever and he'll be fine. But they'd be late. All the time they'd be late. If you got in contract that you got paid last day of the month, they'd be free. Well, you could go up to a week late at the beginning of the first year. Second year got later, and in my last year it was a shambles because I was late but getting paid a penny, like sometimes 3 or 4 months.
So you didn't get paid for 3 or 4 months?
I didn't get paid for 5-6 months in the last little bit of the last 6 months being there. And that's the only bit that went wrong. I lost my position, like, fairly. Like, I dipped in form. The lad at Benfica now, his class, he was coming up. He was like a German Greek, and he took my place. Only for, like, the last 6 months. But I played all the games in Europe that year. So I still had, like, enough to keep me going. But then they made it clear that they had to get rid of the budget, wanted me out. And I didn't get a penny, John, for, I think it was 6 months. Like, not
a penny. Did you get it eventually?
I cut a deal with them to leave because I was like happy to leave. But when I talk about falling in love with a club, I didn't want to take the piss. This has happened to a lot of players and they've just gone, right, we're going to FIFA, you know, and it's taken years. SEN.
I don't think getting the money, your wages that you're owed is taking the piss.
No, but I knew that what had happened to people like STN and a German lad, of friend of mine, he was literally not training, not seen. He was like not getting a penny. He'd gone through FIFA, and everybody thinks FIFA will just sort it. They'll pay you. It takes years. And even then, they don't have to pay. They can drip feed it over 5-6 years. I didn't want that. And I knew the financial trouble they were in and just wanted to leave on a positive. So I did a deal, basically, to leave. I sliced a bit on the off the top, you know, maybe a European bonus. So they give me money. And again, I just thought, time to go. 3 years, just over 3 years I was there. Knew I had Bristol who wanted me. So I just went there. And I just wanted to give a little bit back, you know? Like, not as a hero, but I literally couldn't take that money.
Because they'd given you this life experience?
Yeah, in a way. But I knew from the pain from the fans, who have nothing to do with the financial situation, they were struggling so much at where their club was going. And the president had pulled his money and said, look, I'm not paying all this big money, blah, 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 anymore. I just felt like it was the right thing to do, and I was
more about Panathinaikos.
Fuck them. Give me another 6 years.
But I would have had to stay another year. I had another year in my contract. I would have had to stay another year. I might not have even trained with the team, because if they want someone out, they want someone out. And I didn't want that to happen.
The fact that you had Bristol to come home to.
Yeah, well, I kept that hush, and that's how I played it. Again, you have to learn these things to, you know, who's got the control? Who's got the power? When you've got no club to go to.
Oh, are you now?
Yeah.
Oh, right.
Exactly.
Yeah, we'll slice a little bit more off the top then.
Exactly.
Big dog.
And by this time, Gilberto Silva, hang on a minute. Gilberto, who was the Arsenal player, who was a midfielder.
Yeah. Silva.
Yeah. Is it Silva? Gilberto Silva.
Yeah.
Yeah. World Cup winner. Yeah. He was our sporting director. And like, you know, even he didn't have the power, so...
How can Gilberto, the sporting director, World Cup winner, knowing that lads are not getting paid? I don't understand how people can do that.
But you think that was part of the process of you leaving? Like you said, you've fallen out of favour and you've been paid no problem up to that point, and it, maybe the club did want you to leave, so it's like, right, we'll stop paying him now.
Because they paid other players, the ones that they wanted to keep, they paid. They just didn't pay me. But what do you do as a player? Like, you think that you're protected by all these FIFAs, but look at like Leeds and Wimbledon or Rushden Diamonds have gone out of business. It's not as straightforward as players think, and they don't realise how lucky they are to play in this country and get the regular income. Because when you go across Europe, you've seen it in Italy, in the Serie A, you know, Juventus have been relegated. Happens loads of countries. Okay, Germany's very solid. Holland's quite solid. Scandinavia's getting that way. But there's so many countries out there that don't have that stability in the financial sector. But over there, mate, there was clubs that I knew. Obviously, I got to know everything. There was clubs in the Super League, the top league, not getting paid. If they'd started bad or they had a bad run, they wouldn't get paid.
Mm.
Or they'd get cash. A lot of cash flying about.
So it was all set up, return to Bristol.
Yeah,
when
it wasn't
you got back and
yeah, it wasn't easy getting back to England, to be honest. It wasn't like I had loads of options. I think when you're abroad it's great, but then you get forgotten and people don't really care about outside the Premier League or the English leagues. But I went to Bristol City, signed like a 1 year deal with an option. And yeah, it was a good club. Lee Johnson was manager.
I did him at Barnsley.
No.
Never
met him. But he was very into his, like, playing out from the back, but, like, exit routes, and he called him, and he was very, like, 2017 at the time.
A modern day.
Yeah, even for me, it was like, oh, right, okay. I thought you meant exit routes as in the ways out of the stadium. That's true, that is. But he was, like, somebody who was keen to get me on board, said, come in and play.
Speak to him directly?
Yes, directly. Very, very good speaker. To this day, I think he's one of the best speakers I've heard. Him and Gary Rowett to address a changing room full of lads. He's brilliant. But he said, come in, you and Frank Fielding, fight out for number one. And he said to me, clear as day, he says, look, I know obviously Frank's doing well. You've come in a bit late, like after a couple of games. He said, but you'll get the cup games in the Carling Cup or the whatever it was called 3 years ago. So, okay, I went along with that, played... flew over, like literally trained straight away. That was my, and then I was out, you know, my cleaner moved me out of the apartment in Greece. She flew all my stuff over to England and my partner.
Boxed her off.
Cash in hand. Cash in hand. But yeah, then, and like my first game, we beat Stoke in the cup, played well, beat Crystal Palace. I'm going to whiz through this story, by the way, but obviously then got to the quarterfinals, played Man U. We beat them 2-1. A fantastic night, you know.
On Sky, I think. I can remember watching that.
Yeah. And it's not easy to play once a month or every 6 weeks. And that was a huge game, you know, packed stadium. And I had quite a bit to do, made a few good saves, played well. Do you know what I mean? I played, you know, I probably didn't kick as well as I can do, but I remember making big saves. We scored in the last minute. We beat Man U. Ibrahimovic scored the free kick, a deflected free kick. And then we're in the semi-final. And then the day before the semi-final, he called me in the office and I knew something was up. I could just feel it as a player. You do.
Come on, Lee.
Yeah. And like, you know what I'm going to say? He sat me down. He's like, this is such a hard thing to say, but Frank's playing tomorrow. I'm going to put Frank in. And obviously he was the regular goalkeeper. And I was like, I thought it was given. You know what's coming. I knew it was coming when he got called into the office, but I was told I'm going to get the games until we're out of the cup.
Mm. Yeah.
And I think I even joked to him, oh, I'll have to win it then, like, you know, at the time. And he dropped me and he put Frank in, who'd have been playing well in the league, but obviously I was the Carling Cup man. I got, you know, it's gone down as the best win ever in the club's history to beat Man U in the quarterfinal. We're in the semi-final for God knows how long. And, you know, he's dropped me and I was devastated, absolutely devastated, away at City. It's a two-legged thing. You know, I was on the bench and we lost 2-1 that night, but...
You not think about giving it the old, fucking hell, that's fucking bang out and I'm having to pop it in. Yeah.
Shitbag move, really. I think even all the fans would see that from an outside perspective as well.
Yeah, well, they all thought I was injured or something. I don't even think I told people. I was that pissed off. And, you know, that the wind had been taken out of me. I was, like, really, you know, taken back by it.
Do you know, the when you said that I've lost my head twice, that would have been one where I'd lose my head at that. You know, when you said that, like, it's fucking scandalous, really, isn't it?
It's scandalous, but... I didn't lose my head. I can't remember why, but I remember just being really quiet. You know, I was really, I don't know, I probably weren't in a confident way. I don't know what it was about me. That's what I mean. If you catch me on that sort of mood, that's how I'm going to react.
You got lucky then, Johnson.
Yeah, I think so. But but the ironic thing is, he played in the first leg, but then on the Wednesday night at Derby, got injured at half time. I came on, we drew 0-0, and I played in the second leg. But
she had thrown a couple in me just to fuck him off.
Yeah,
fucking serves you right.
Yeah, and obviously I'm, you know, I try to be, I was professional and I was happy to play. And it was a huge game. I think we lost 3-2 in the end, but we were going for the winner in the last few minutes, and that's how it goes. And you know, that swings and roundabouts. And that was like the first sign of me becoming not a number one, if you know what I mean. Really, and that was a weird season, because at the end of the year, I knew that he wanted another goalkeeper, Dean Henderson. And I was in Greece, actually, on holiday, and he called me, which, like, I thought my year was going to be extended, but I'd heard whispers, because everybody talks, especially goalkeepers, and I knew that he was after this goalie, that goalie. So, you know, he rang me and said, look, sorry, mate, but we're not going to keep you. And I'd bought a place down in Bristol and all of that. But the thing is, right, he doesn't know this, and I'm quite good at hiding it. I was bladdered. I was steaming drunk when he called me, like steaming drunk. And I remember just telling him, and he was like, look, the reason, and I was like, Gaffy, you don't have to tell me. And I kept telling him, Gaffy, you don't have to tell me. Gaffy, you don't have to tell me. And he wouldn't know, unless he watches this now, I was steaming drunk, but I was like upset. And I was thinking, flipping heck, I'm going to have to find a new club. I bought a place there. You know, I'd done well in the games. Not like, it's not easy coming into like bit part player.
And he's probably come away from that when he took that quite well, actually.
Yeah, and he kept saying, why don't you want to hear? I said, it doesn't matter. Just, I don't want to hear it. I don't want to hear it, because I know what you're going to say, but I know the reasons. I didn't want him to lie as well, because I quite got on with him. But, you know, he wasn't a goalkeeper man, I must say. He's not, and a lot of managers are not. A lot of managers don't have a clue, because it's kind of a different sport in a way. But
I think it's more prevalent recently with Alisson and the him at Man City. And to do it here as well. I think people have realised now it's a specialist position and can win your points.
Yeah.
And I fucking used to hate goalies, me. Fucking morning bastards and all that. But it is now a specialist position. Always were, but it's more seen that it is now.
Yeah. Exactly. And some people try and cheat the goalie like an outfield player, and it doesn't work. Because you train separately, you kind of, you know, you've got to treat them differently depending on whether they're number one, two, old, young, strong mentally, not. And that was it. I left there. I had a good 3 months off.
good 3 months.
In Greece?
No, I stayed there a bit longer than normal, but yeah, I moved back and I was back in England and then signed for Forest just after that.
Which was your dream move?
Which was my dream move, yeah. Agent produced again there.
I think he had a bit of bad press, mate. He's grown into his role, hasn't he, really? Yeah. He's got you to Greece. He's got you to Forest. Why would Forest your dream move?
It was just one of them ones when someone asks you, oh, who would you love to play for? And I'd be like, oh, of course, Man U, AC Milan. But realistically, I want to play for Forest. It's an hour away from my house. It's a great stadium, always a good pitch. Just always had that, like, feeling about it, and that was my sort of target to play. And I thought, oh, wouldn't that be class if I get Forest? Never thought it could happen. And then it's funny because the owners of Olympiacos own Forest, right. So then they called me, or called my agent and said, look, would Luke come and blah blah blah, and they gave me a 2-year deal at 34, or was nearly 35. It was like flipping heck. Lucky Luke again. Like, I've had great time at Barnsley, now I've had 3 years playing abroad in Europa League, I've, you know, been at Bristol, but, like, you know, now going to get 2 years at Forest. And I went there flipping, you know, bang on it. Karanka was manager, a bit of a football style, but it didn't really work.
Well, the dream not what you'd anticipated.
You built it all well. Mate, the dream was like, it was ran differently. It was ran like Greeks, and I was used to that. And the intensity of, like, the way they acted and the way that people from outside of the change room would speak and things like that. And, you know, I got a few chances, played in the cup, we did quite well in the cup, beat Newcastle, beat Stoke again, and, you know, if we should have got into a quarter finals again, but
not dependent. Yeah,
hey, oh yeah, I scored on my debut. lucky Luke again, first week. Obviously I came a bit late to the season, I was a couple of games in, so I weren't on the bench for the league, was on the bench for the Carling Cup. After 20 minutes, the keeper had made a mistake already, actually, and then came rushing out and got sent off. So my first ever time I've been stripped, like, for the game, I got on. So I got on against Bury. We were 1-0 down. We scored in the last few minutes. Matty Cash played quite well, and then went to penalties and, yeah, scored. I think I was number 7, I think, or 8. I've saved a few penalties, and we went through on penalties.
Was it the winning penalty?
It was scored and then I saved and then we went through, so yeah.
Oh, we're confident taking it.
That's right, the Rovers stuff, isn't it?
Mate, the goal's small. When you're taking penalties. I'd missed one actually for Barnsley, so I'd hit the bar in a penalty shootout years before. But no, I was confident, really. I was confident. The time in Greece made me so confident in terms of my footwork and things like that, my touch. It was just what I needed.
It's come to fruition now, hasn't it, on a Sunday morning?
And I slotted it away, yeah.
Were there any problems getting paid at Forest?
No problems.
Did you not think the thought, we can't do it in England, we can get away with it in Greece, but we can't in England?
Yeah, they knew they couldn't get away with it there. They try lots of tricks and bits and bobs, but at Forest, they've had so many players in those 2 years I was there, so many players, ins and outs and ins and outs. It's such a mixed bag of people from all over just thrown together. I mean, it was tragic that they didn't get in the playoffs last year, but part of me thought, I'm not surprised because there's no consistency and, you know.
Are they still there now then, are they, the owners?
Yeah, the owners are still there. Yeah. Marinakis, who owns Olympiacos, owns both.
So now you're still teetering, you still want to be playing?
What, right now?
Yeah, but you're...
I don't know. I was hoping you guys would actually help me decide because I'm actually in a weird position right now where I don't know whether to carry on, like, playing in goal, that is, or just not. So
are you missing it?
Over to you. I trained yesterday for the first time with a conference side, just with a Goldie coach, and I quite enjoyed it. It was hard work, like, you know, quite enjoyed it, but a part of me doesn't really miss the football club scene.
Tell you what it were for me, I weren't playing my last year, I weren't really playing, and I weren't knocking the manager's door down on a Monday morning saying, why am I not playing? And that was the thing that for me teetered me, like, well, that's, I've had enough then.
Yeah,
you've got your youth dreams project,
yeah,
which is the thing you started a few years ago.
Yeah, I've got a business that does a lot of good work within, like, the schools and the within the youth, really. It's a mixed bag. It's not just football, different sports, and that's, I enjoy that. I enjoy the business side of that. I don't coach as such. I talk to assemblies and,
you know, we try and we've got something going on in Greece, actually, like doing the half-term camps and that. But all the business side, I think that's what I'm going to continue once I officially finish. But at the moment, I feel like, especially yesterday, when I trained, I felt exactly like I did 5 years ago, 10 years ago. Sharpness and, okay, a bit of fitness just because I haven't trained for 3 months. But I don't know if I love it enough to really go for it. And the offers I've had have all been 3 hours plus away, and I've said no. And I feel like at the moment, I'm these next few weeks that I need to decide one way or another if I'm going to carry on, to be honest. And I don't know the answer. I don't know the answer right now. I couldn't tell you what I want to do.
So, do you not think the fact that you don't know the answer is the answer?
Maybe. Maybe. Like you, I've not, last year at Millwall, never knocked on the door once to Rowett. I thought that number one was better than me and playing better than me. So, you know, I just got on with it. I don't know. I don't know what to do. I feel like I don't want to be one of those that drags it out until I literally can't move, you know. But at the same time, I want to give it a go if there's something that comes my way. But I just don't think the... I think I've fallen out of love with goalkeeping a bit. That's why I'm playing up front.
The thing so is as well, mate, obviously you've had your history, you're Bradley Dack as well. You've got a young family. Yeah. Do you want to be sat in one of them casts for... Your agent's phoned me this morning.
John's on the opinion no, right? Brilliant.
That's what it is for me.
The one thing that's like making me want to play is the fact that my mum, my dad, my brothers, who enjoy watching me play, I feel like I want to carry on for them, because they'll see it as a bit of a waste because they know that I'm physically the same as I was 5 years ago. And I feel like a bit of a letdown if I don't carry on playing. And not just to them, as for other people as well. And I know players like Chris, who got injured prematurely, like my friend Jamie Day, who was a top, top player who retired at, I think he was 24, 25.
Is he coaching?
Down at Plymouth, Jamie Day is.
Oh, no, I'm thinking of a different one then, sorry.
For all those reasons, I feel like I should just carry on and just get on with it. But, you know, we'll see. Time will tell.
Get your boots on. We'll get in the back garden.
Yeah.
Get the camera
ready. Turn the lights around. We'll put these lights out here.
We'll do a highlights reel.
Yeah.
Let's do it. I'll be Mervyn Deer.
I'm going to be Barry Fry. I'll get my top off. You got an old belt or something.
He could be Fabian Bartos.
Are we on fags?
In a Marlboro Light, that back with your slip on.
Nah, good luck, Stevie. Yeah, you've got plenty in the tank.
Cheers, lads. You met the right decision.
Thanks very much. It's been good to chat nonsense for a while.
Brilliant, mate. Cheers.
Top man.
Nice one, mate.
Well done, everyone.